Court of the State of Iowa is now in session.
Thank you, everyone. Please be seated. And welcome to this special session of the Iowa Supreme Court held at the University of Iowa College of Law. We have one case that will be submitted this morning. The case is Vanilla Games Incorporated versus the Iowa Department of Inspections and Appeals. Ms. Walker, you may proceed.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice. May it please this honorable court, thank you for retaining this appeal and allowing argument to be presented by Mr. Ranch and I at this 90th anniversary of this event at the College of Law. My client, Vanilla Games, is the developer of two electronic amusement devices, Superior Skill 1 and Superior Skill 2. These two devices operate essentially the same, with the exception of visual themes which are expressed on an electronic viewing device as they are presented to the player. Vanilla filed its petition with the appellee, the Department of Inspections and Appeals, seeking a declaration, among other things, that the games were not subject to the registration requirements of Iowa Code Section 99B.53.1. And most notably, Vanilla requested a ruling that the outcomes of the games were primarily determined by the skill or knowledge of the player. The DIA found that the games were subject to the registration requirement, and in so doing found that the outcome of the games was not primarily determined by the skill of the player. It made no specific finding as it related to the knowledge component.
Hypothetically, if a game is dependent on the skill of a player, shouldn't a player be able to win 100% of the time if they're skillful?
Well, Justice Wiggins, my first question would be, what is the meaning of winning in the particular context of this appeal? Can they successfully solve a puzzle? I would agree that a highly skilled player should be able to successfully complete the puzzle presented, but more than a less skilled player.
But your game has these predetermined stops where you, no matter how skilled you are, you couldn't win. And I'm using win in the sense of getting money back or coupons or however you want to call it.
If you are using it in the sense, Justice Wiggins, of winning more than may be put into the machine in terms of a credit or an increment, we would disagree because of the unique facet of these games in the sense that the player has the ability before any puzzle or any screen is presented to know exactly what the outcome would be and to then make several choices, and that outcome being how many credits would the player win in the event that he or she successfully completes the skill test.
So what the player has to do is walk away. I can't win, I can't get any credits this time, I'm going to walk away and I'll come back later. But you have these predetermined spins.
Justice, I would respectfully disagree. That's what the DIA found. However, the player is actually presented with a number of options at that point. Each one of these games has five different themes, and each one of these games has 12 increments of play within each of these five themes. The player, if it's presented with a screen that he or she desires not to play because of the potential credit that they can garner from completing the skill task, can then, at no expense, go to a different theme. And they can activate the prize viewer to find out if the result would be different or the outcome would be different. Or they could change the increment within the same theme and do the same thing.
But eventually, when they go to screen, there is a point when they're not going to win in any game.
If winning is
getting credits,
is getting more than has been put into the machine, That's correct. At some point, that will happen.
All right, so counsel, thank you. Just 7 days ago, the Florida Court of Appeals addressed a similar device and rejected the argument that having a look at the next screen made a difference. Should we follow that case, or how would you distinguish it?
Well, if you're referring, Your Honor, to the Gator Coin case,
I am.
First of all, I believe that was actually the Florida Court of Appeals in an unpublished opinion. And, of course, similar to our jurisprudence, it is unpublished. It's subject to being withdrawn and is not authoritative. The other thing I would say about the Gator Coin case is that the statutory framework behind that particular decision is dramatically different than what we have here in Iowa. Specifically, the issue there was whether or not that game was a slot machine. And if the game expresses symbols that are traditional slot machine symbols, there is an absolute rebuttable presumption that it is a slot machine. The other thing is that game did not have any element of skill, nor did it have any element of knowledge, nor did the statute have any element of knowledge. So it's dramatically different. It's not authoritative, and we would respectfully submit that this court.
Now, the state also relies on the North Carolina Supreme Court decision that is published. How would you distinguish that?
Well, if, Your Honor, you are referring to and I'm looking for the name of that case.
Where the Court of Appeals had a split decision and the State Supreme Court adopted the dissenting view.
Right. I think in that case, the dissenting view, the State Supreme Court did not rule on the merits. And that was similar to most of the cases that have been cited by the DNA, if not all of them, provide that there's no knowledge component and no skill component in terms of the analysis, with the exception that in some cases there may have been an element of skill the converse, an element of chance would render it under the statutory framework a game of chance. And I think that was the case in the North Carolina case that you cited. And a close reading of that case indicates that the North Carolina Supreme Court reversed it essentially on procedural grounds. It was related to a preliminary injunction that had been granted.
I've read the opinion as saying there's a per curiam reversal by the Supreme Court saying this is reversed for the reasons stated in the dissent. And the dissent concludes that the game is a game of chance and not a game of skill. So sounds like the merits to me.
Well, Justice Manfield, I would agree to the extent that it applied to the plenary injunction. And again, the statutory framework is certainly different than the Iowa statutory framework, which is significantly different. And in that particular game, there was no opportunity for the player to exercise skill, nor was there a knowledge component in the underlying statute. It was merely, was this a slot machine?
Let's talk about that knowledge component. I mean, I think your argument is because you look at the viewer and decide to play that or to switch over or walk away, whatever, that meets the knowledge component. But is that what the legislature intended? Or were they trying to get to these trivia games that are played in these restaurants where it's the knowledge of the player as of the subject matter versus the knowledge of whether you're going to get credits that time?
Well, respectively, Your Honor, I don't know that we get to the legislative intent in this particular case because there's been no contention that this statute is ambiguous. And I think that the rules of construction are that this court should apply the plain meaning.
What's the plain meaning of the term outcome? I'm sorry for interrupting, but as you're saying, there's no ambiguity. I'm struggling with the question of what's the meaning of the term, quote, outcome of the statute. And
well,
no one walks away with a bag of money. Nobody, no one could be a professional. I mean, you could be a professional poker player, I get it. But nobody could be a professional at your game, if I understand it correctly. And I know you'll push back if I say something incorrect. Instead, you can get credits, kind of extend the game. But doesn't the meaning of the term, quote, outcome, have bearing here?
Well, I do believe that the term outcome has a great deal of bearing, Your Honor. And to the extent that no one walks away with a bag of money, there's nothing in the record that would suggest that. Some players can exercise greater skill and greater knowledge than others and do better. But I think that's a logical conclusion. And the other, I'm sorry,
No, please.
And under the statutory framework, no one can walk away with a bag of money anyway because it's capped at $50 of credit for the particular location.
So you can play the game. You can play the game longer, apparently, if you're skilled.
You can play the game for any duration, Your Honor, and you can walk away, or you can play any of 60 different iterations that would be available to you.
Is there anything you get beyond extended play?
Well, yes, you, under the statutory framework, you can at any time punch out a ticket and take that for merchandise and the particular location.
What do you make of the way the machine's set? I think it's 92, 93, or 97. Sort of like, you know, when you go to Las Vegas, you go down this trip, our slot machines are 98, and ours are 94, and ours are 92, so come play us because you'll get your money back. I mean, doesn't that seem to predetermine that the house is going to win anywhere from 8 to 3% of the time?
Well, my reaction to that would be yes. In the long run, that's correct. The house is going to win. And that is typically the case with any amusement.
So with all the skill and all the knowledge, the house is going to win in an infinite amount of time, in an infinite amount of plays.
Yeah, over 75,000 or 100,000 iterations of the game, that would be correct. But that's not a factor in the statute that we're asking to be construed respectfully.
Well, then again, if you could win with knowledge, you know, it's guy in jeopardy with millions of dollars because of his knowledge. If you can win with knowledge, you should be able, if you're a real smart person and you're really skillful, you should win every time.
And there's nothing in the record that would suggest that that couldn't be the case.
I interrupted your answer, Justice.
May I finish my point?
Yes.
Thank you.
I've got one for you. You just distinguished your case from the Florida case by making a statement that Florida case does not have the prize viewer. It's my understanding they did. And your brief talks about the prize viewer being a critical part of proving that there's knowledge involved. So I just want to make sure I understand your argument. I understand you want to distinguish the Florida case, but they do seem very similar.
Would you like me to respond to more distinctions?
My understanding, is it correct that the Florida case does involve a prize viewer?
Well, that was, of course, in supplemental authority that was provided to the court this week, and at the time that our brief was written, there was no such indication that there was any other case that had a prize viewer, per se. But again, it's a different statutory framework that we're talking about in the Florida case, Your Honor, because it concerns whether it's a slot machine. It has no component of skill or knowledge, and there's a rebuttable presumption that if it even uses icons or symbols that are similar to a slot machine, then it's not a legal device.
But you're arguing in your brief that knowledge is shown by having the prize viewer, correct?
I would agree, yes.
Okay, and then if this other case has a prize viewer as well, wouldn't that make them somewhat similar as far as the knowledge aspect?
Well, again, knowledge is not a factor in that particular statute in Florida, Your Honor. That is unique to the Iowa legislation that we're dealing with, 99B.53.
Mr. Locker, the statute says primarily. So the issue, I think everyone would agree the game is partly a game of skill and knowledge, partly a game of chance. And would it be fair to say that if primarily the success of a player is going to be due to the screens, which is a matter of chance, as opposed to the knowledge or skill of the player, that it's that it, that then must be considered a game of chance? Isn't that fair?
I would respectfully disagree with that concept, Your Honor.
And why?
I would disagree because no one disputes in this case that skill is required in order to complete a puzzle. No dispute about that. So in the absence of skill, there is no result, even if the court considers the outcome to be winning. The second component of it is that no player need play any particular screen that is prevented because of the prize viewer. They can opt out. They don't have to play that particular puzzle or that game. They have 60 iterations which they can play, or in fact, they can walk away. And it's inevitable that everyone is going to walk away from a game at some point in time for whatever particular reason. So I, again, would respectfully disagree that it would be fair to say that, as you have suggested.
Mr. Lochner, thank you.
I'm out of time. Thank you.
Mr. Rand.
Thank you, Mr. Chief Justice, and may it please the court. In 1843, Iowa wasn't even a state yet, but the territorial Supreme Court discussed weighing chance against skill. Way back then, 175 years ago, the court concluded, just because there is some intermingling of skill and chance does not prevent the game from being dependent, quote, in a very considerable degree upon chance. It also concluded that doesn't prevent the game from being a game of chance within the meaning of the law.
Yeah, I want to focus on the knowledge part of the statute. Somebody who's playing this game can look at that viewer. I'm not going to get any credits this time. It's impossible. And then switch to another game. I'm not going to get any. And go through that till he or she finds a game where they'll get credits. Or if there's no credits, they can take their coupon out, sit down, and come back 10 minutes later, and hopefully the game resets because someone else intervened, and then start playing with the knowledge when to play the game, when to play the game where there's credits available, and assuming in that this question, they have the skill to move those things up and down or back and forth. So why is it a knowledge-based? If someone can do that, now it may take 6 days to win $50, but you know, $50 a credit, but why isn't it knowledge-based under that circumstance?
It's not knowledge-based because knowledge about when to play the game does not in any respect affect the screen that appears. Every word in the statute, 99B53, has work to do. The one that we're focused on with your question, Justice Wiggins, is determined. The knowledge of what screen is going to appear and the knowledge that you can win does not in any way influence what screen appears and does not make you more or less likely to be able to.
But any game of skill has a knowledge component. You have baseball, you know, when to bunt, when to intentionally walk someone. You have football, when to pass it, and when to run. I mean, and you base it on the knowledge of what works and what doesn't work. And it seems to me that if someone can just see what they're going to win, take their thing and sit down and come back 20 minutes later or a day later or bring their credits the next day, they do have the requisite knowledge to beat the machine.
They're not beating the machine, though, because there is a preset retention ratio over time.
Yeah, but there's a preset. But they get around the preset retention ratio by the fact that they know when it's going to hit and when it's not going to hit, and they sit down. It's like blackjack. You know, blackjack, the house will win 3.3 or 4% of the time. You count cards, you're going to win 3 or 4%, 0.3 or 4% of the time. So you change the game based on knowledge, and you count cards up right out of the casino, but
speaking from experience.
I saw the movie. But the real issue is, you know, someone can use that knowledge and when it's going to, I'm using it, but that's probably a bad term. When there's credits available, when there's credits are not available, can beat the machine. It's going to take a long time, but they can't do it.
Yeah. Again, your knowledge of the game rules and of strategy is not actually influencing the result here. Take poker, for example. Once you get your cards, there may be some strategy that you know that you
can do. Poker's a game of chance. I mean, poker's a game of chance because even with all the knowledge in the world, it's dependent on the cards that are dealt with you.
Exactly. This is dependent on the screen that it's...
Well, but you could opt out of that screen and walk away. When you're dealt your hand in poker, you pay your ante. And you have to walk away and put something in the pot unless you play no ante.
Mr. Ranch, do you agree that knowledge and skill are different standards?
Yes, they're disjunctive in the statute, primarily determined by skill or knowledge. The knowledge here, again, is just giving you better information before you put your money down. It's not actually influencing the result at all. Skill is a different inquiry. And
would you agree that a player that is very knowledgeable about the game and how it operates, just like you and Mr. Lochner, would have a better opportunity to accumulate points or credits than someone that has no knowledge about the game and just started playing it?
Slightly better, but it's all a matter of degree. And as I said before, every statute or every word in the statute does work. So the laboring lore under your question now is primarily. So even though Mr. Loper and I may have superior understanding of how the game works, that doesn't affect the screen that comes up at all, and it doesn't affect the notion that even at a high watermark, 70% of the time I'm going to lose no matter how much knowledge or how much skill I have.
What weight should we give the Florida case that you alerted to us to from a week ago? Opposing counsel had reasons to distinguish it. What's your response?
Well, the first one was that it's unpublished, and I think that's pretty normal for cases that are only 8 days old from an intermediate appellate court. There hasn't been a publication order yet. Certainly possible it could be in the future. My second point is that certainly without a lot of authority elsewhere, it's reasonable to rely on something rather than nothing. And the third one is just because the Florida framework is a little more strict, right? It's either a legal machine or it's a slot machine and it's illegal. Okay, we're a little more Iowa nice up here. And we say, okay, it may not be a slot machine, but if it's still based on chance, we're still going to limit where you can put it. It's only in a place with a liquor license. We're still going to limit who can play it. It's people over 21, just with other kinds of gambling. We're still going to limit how many there can be in the state and how many there can be in any one location. So just because Iowa is a little more lenient than the Florida framework doesn't suggest to me that the Florida framework should be tossed out and disregarded. And apart from Florida, there's an Iowa case that talks about the prize viewer. That's Ellis, that's 1925. Same sort of situation, just because the legal framework at that time was a little different, and it was a legal, illegal, black and white line. Ellis still tells us how we measure prize and chance against skill or knowledge, right? Ellis says, okay, this is a vending machine and I'm gonna get mints every time, but sometimes there'll be an indicator, and that indicator will tell me. I might get a gift certificate to the general store along with these mints. That case alone tells me that the preview feature doesn't remove chance to a material enough degree to make knowledge the primary factor driving the outcome of the device. I would also refer again to the North Carolina case for the reasons stated in the dissent, which says this nudging skill task is not primary over the generation of the preset order of screens. And even the Kansas case says that if you use some skill or some knowledge, that initial chance event, what screen you are dealt, what screen gets pulled up, you cannot control that. It's still a game of chance. All those things together are very strong authority in support of what the DIA did here.
What
What's your best argument on the relative deference point? And let me say I'm having an uphill struggle on the issue of deference. The legislature did not expressly, I think we all agree, the legislature did not expressly tell us to defer to agency interpretations of the statute. So the only question is, you know, under Renda, should we nonetheless give deference? The terms here are pretty general. I mean, outcome, we're talking about outcome, and primarily and dominant. These are kind of terms that, of course, you know, struggled with since time immemorial. What's your best point to suggest that we ought to defer to the agency interpretation?
Well, my point that I made in the brief, Your Honor, is that you don't even need to get to that question because DIA was right about the statute.
Well, I understand that. But are you conceding the point that Renda deference is not appropriate here?
I'm conceding that you only need to get there if you first say that DIA was wrong. Gambling is a very heavily regulated field, and so there should be, especially under cases like ABC Disposal, some deference there. I understand, of course, that the Court of Appeals said that DIA, in a case like this, didn't get deference pre-Renda. Okay, that's what the case says. Again, I really don't think you need to go down that road. I really don't think that the ink needs to be spent on this because it's first only to determine whether the DIA was right or wrong about the statute. I'm going to go back again to the word outcome. Really, all that needs to happen under outcome is for the court to determine this can't be something subjective, some subjective sense of fun and mirth, right? Whether you measure outcome in a holistic sense or in a granular sense.
What about the merchandise? We've heard about the merchandise you can get as an outcome.
That's not an outcome of the device. The merchandise that you can get, you know, you buy drinks or you buy food or you buy the trucker hat that's got the bar's logo on it, that's not an outcome of the device. The outcome of the device is, here's a ticket for $50, go get that. Where I'm driving at is, all that the court needs to do is determine, is rule out the notion that outcome is measured in smiles and giggles and chuckles, and it's measured instead in screens, credits, dollars, tickets, those kinds of things. That subjective concept of amusement, writ large on its own, the emotion can't be the outcome here because then no device at all could be regulated. And the district court recognized as much. The page there is 251 of the appendix. This framework is two steps, right? There's 99B52, which says you get out from underneath the presumption that all gambling is illegal if you first demonstrate all of these factors. Okay, DIA ruled here that this device meets all those factors. Then the second part of the framework is 99B53, and that's where we are here. If there's a continuum with something that's purely chance on one end and purely skill on the other, the closer we are to pure chance, the greater the interest the legislature has in regulating that closely. And so that skill and knowledge fulcrum right in the middle is the point. And the legislature set a balance by using the word primarily. It's just the method of sorting out what is closest to pure chance.
Why should we favor a holistic approach of extended play versus just one screen at a time?
Because that's most realistic. That's the reality of how people use these devices, and I don't think the court needs to blind itself to that. With that said, of course, as I just explained, really that outcome, pun intended, is not determinative of the case. Whether outcome is measured at the screen level or more holistically, the test is still the same. Is it primary determined by skill or knowledge? And under either formulation, the preset order that the screens appear in is still the primary determining factor. And for support on that, I would point to the Kansas case, which goes through that analysis and says, okay, we're going to view this on a, I don't know if it's per screen or a per hand basis, but they do it at a micro level. Nonetheless, Kansas says, that game is still a game of chance, even viewed at that lower level. And so no matter which way you slice it, the court can get there. I don't think that a definitive ruling on how we measure outcome is necessary for resolution of this case.
So you concede, I gather, that a skilled player has a better chance of extended play.
Better, but not primary. Primary is the key word. Yes, it's true. If I have the best hand-eye coordination in the world and can recognize, yes, I need to flip that reel up, and I need to, on the next one, I need to flip this reel down, he will have a better chance at succeeding. But it is just as likely that you could sit there, as you are sitting there now, with your elbow on the nudge left reel button, and come away doing just as well as another player. So to sum up, again, every word in the statute does legwork here. Outcome, primary, determined. If you happen to find yourself down at the Dublin Underground later, I looked this up, one of these amusement devices is there. You can look at it in person. You can see how it works. But there's a sticker on it that says registered by DIA. That's because the outcome is not primarily determined by skill or knowledge, and the court should affirm the district court's ruling. Thanks.
Mr. Ranch, thank you as well. Ms. Bunker, you may present your rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. I have time to address a couple of points. First of them is the what has been termed the holistic approach to evaluating this particular game. And I go back to the literal terms of the statute, which everyone seems to agree can be interpreted by plain language. And there is no ambiguity. The statute claims that the outcome that an electronic device must be registered if the outcome is not primarily determined by skill or knowledge of the operator. There's no reference in the statute relating to the device. It's obvious that skill and knowledge have to be owned by the player, not the machine. The trial court, upon review, said that it would be ridiculous to assume that a player would play 75,000 or 100,000 different screens in order to garner some order.
What other games out there are covered by the knowledge element of this statute? I mean,
none that I'm aware of, Your Honor, and there's nothing in the record to that effect. So
what games would be then? Let's hypothetically tell me. I can think of trivia games where you get four questions, you get a question, and you have to answer, pick a result, and if you're pretty good at it, you do. I've seen those in restaurants, not bars. But you know of any other games?
Well, not that come to mind, Your Honor. I'm sure there are. And I would agree that a trivia game would seem to fall into that category. And, of course, my knowledge is imperfect, certainly imperfect of the law.
But when the legislature passed the statute, the only games out there were trivia games. I think your machines weren't around.
This statute was passed in 2015. We have to assume that the legislature knew what it was doing. And the term outcome and prize are used within the same sentence in the statute. So obviously, the legislature saw outcome as having some distinct meaning.
Doesn't outcome assume that you did something affirmatively, not walk away? I mean, that's my other problem with this knowledge thing, because the outcome is once you put things in motion, what the result's going to be, not that you didn't put anything in motion and went and had another beer.
Justice, you indicated earlier that I think you wanted me to assume that the outcome had to be a win. And again, I want to be clear that we don't concede that that's provided for in the statute. And
what basis
if you apply fine.
What basis do you have in the statute to say it's not whether you win a prize or not? Because if you look at all 99B and all the gambling statutes, they're only concerned about prizes. They're not concerned about anything else in any of those statutes.
That particular section of 99B that we're referring to uses games which give a prize as a differentiating topic. However, in the body of the statute itself, it talks about outcome and prize. It doesn't say that a player has to win a prize. It doesn't say how much. It doesn't even define what the word prize is. And in fact, this game has a feature where a player can opt to pick a penny on every particular iteration.
Why can't prize just be a subset of outcome? There are some outcomes that are prizes, and there are some outcomes that are not. If if the selection of what you get, whether you're going to get a prize or no prize, depends primarily on chance and not on the skill and knowledge of the player, at least over the typical run that a player is going to be playing the game, then why isn't that covered by the statute?
I'm not certain that I understand your question, Justice, so my apologies, but in this case, knowledge allows the player to select the very puzzle that he or she intends to play. And that knowledge, unlike mine, is perfect as to the potential outcome. And amusement itself can be an outcome. The statute doesn't provide otherwise. And there are certainly many amusement devices in play that offer no potential for prize that people put money into play. And that in and of itself can be an outcome that ain't amusement. I would be pleased to speak more, but I am out of time. I thank you for your attention. We ask that the ruling of the district court be reversed.
Locker, thank you as well. Mr. Ranch, thank you again. The case of Vanilla Games versus Iowa Department of Inspections and Appeals then is now submitted for decision.